Square is buried deep into the culture of Japan. Originally a spin-off from Masafumi Miyamoto's father's Powerline construction firm, for over 30 years its games have helped power the rise of Japanese games development. There are no shortage of games that live under the Square Enix banner, but none as big as Final Fantasy. From our Western perspective, there's an air of mythos around the company. The accepted truth behind the series' title is that it was named Final Fantasy as it was Square's make-or-break game to avoid impending bankruptcy. And even if the real answer has more to do with creating an acronym that could be pronounced by both Eastern and Western audiences, it's that first story that gets told. That's the legacy of this series. Stories about adventures that get passed from generation to generation. As nearby as the arcades of Akihabara and as far as the playgrounds of Europe. As the Final Fantasy series has moved from numeral to numeral, there have been high points and low. But with each new game comes the promise of a new story. A new myth. The story of what happened with Final Fantasy XIV is one such myth. What we know about it comes from old reviews, archived message board threads, and through conversations with those who were there. The reason for this is that the original version of Final Fantasy XIV doesn't exist anymore. Unlike the vast majority of other old games, there is no way of playing it. It was redacted, painted over. Where once stood a game that threatened to sink the Final Fantasy brand forever, now stands the second most popular subscription MMO in the world. And as the years pass us, the myth of that original version and its incredible redemption story are at risk of disappearing. How did it all happen? How did the same studio that shipped a broken mess turn it all around in 2 years? Why did they make the decision to keep the old version still alive while secretly working on a brand new game? And how did they manage to make all of this, the redesign and rebirth, part of the game's lore? We knew this was a story worth telling, not only for those who were there to see it all go down, but for the millions of you who have never heard about this, who never knew the extraordinary lengths the development team went to save this game. So we did just that. Pack your bags, friends. Noclip is heading to Tokyo. And welcome to Shinjuku, Tokyo, home of Godzilla, restaurants full of dancing robots, and Square Enix, one of the most prolific video game companies in the world. For the past few months, I've been playing catch-up with this story, playing the latest version of the game, talking to players, and watching community retrospective series like the Speakers Network's fantastic Fall and Rise of Final Fantasy XIV. My goal? To make sure we asked the right questions when we sat down with the team. During our time here in Shinjuku, we're going to talk to everyone from the engineers who worked on the original game, to localization leads, community managers, and even the CEO of the company. All to allow them the opportunity to tell their side of this fascinating story.
The fall and rise of Final Fantasy XIV happened in real time in front of millions of people around the world, but we wanted to know about this story from an entirely new perspective, from inside the corporate machine that made it happen, that led to its terrible launch, and ultimately, its incredible rebirth.
My name is Michael Christopher Koji Fonks. I am the English localization lead for Final Fantasy XIV. My middle name being Koji, it's not something I gave myself. It's a name my father gave me. My father was stationed in Japan for 2 years in the Navy when he was young. Went back to the States. My mom had me. They wanted to give me a Japanese name. The family was having none of that, so they kind of snuck it in the middle name, but then they always called me Koji. And right. So I guess the joke was on the rest of the family, you know. My dad, being in the Navy, didn't really learn a lot about Japan other than he really liked Japan, but didn't learn any of the language. So I always knew that my name was Japanese, but beyond that, I really didn't know anything about Japan. But there was always that little seed in there. And then when I got into high school, there's a Japanese class and I like games. Oh, they make games in Japan. Hey, let me study Japanese. If I study Japanese, I can play all those cool Japanese games that never come out over in America. And it kind of just snowballed from there. When I graduated from high school, I took a trip to Japan for 3 weeks, homestay type of thing, and I fell in love with it. And during that period, I got to visit a lot of schools and a lot of English classes in those schools. And I thought, wow, I know English, I could do this, this'll be easy. It wasn't as easy as I thought it was going to be, but I studied a couple years at a university in America, then transferred over to Japan, started over 4 years at a university in Japan.
Wow.
Got my teaching license and
It's hard work being a teacher.
Yes, I mean, I loved it, but I mean, it was very draining. And that's why pretty much after you'd go to school, 6 a.m. for morning basketball practice, because I was the basketball coach, because as my principal said, hey, you're tall, you're the basketball coach. Then you'd get into classes. I mean, I'd have my homeroom class, then I'd have, you know, 6 or 7 other classes teaching, then you'd have after school, all of a sudden it's, oh, there's after school basketball, and then you'd get home and you'd correct. So I was really, you know, always at school every day. It was very draining, and I would go home and I would play FF11. It was how I was able to relax, and being able to go into my little room and turn off the lights and put on my headphones and, you know, get into that world of Vanadio was something that helped me escape from the stress. And then it just happened to be, you know, one day I was online, you know, checking for 11 related information, and I saw that Square Enix was hiring, looking for a translator, and it just kind of, wow, that would be really cool.
Koji wasn't alone. Final Fantasy XIV was launched in 2010, but the story of this game starts 8 years earlier with the launch of Final Fantasy XI, Square's first MMO, the early days of online. Many of the team who worked on XIV started on XI. One of those was Kasuga-san, who joined the company in 1999 to build a network infrastructure for this fledgling MMO.
プレイステーション2で入っていて、なので一番最初にやっていたのが、当時、プレイステーション2で初めて、厳密にはドリームキャストがその前にあるんですけれども、プレイステーション2で、ネットワークを作るために、TCP/IPのドライバーを作ったりとか、まだ当時モデム通信の時代だったんで、PPP通信とか、あと、ADSLがちょうど普及し始めた時期だったんで、ADSL の認証として使われた PPPOE とかっていう、その本当にネットワークの下の部分、今だと普通あんまし誰も書かないようなところを書くっていう担当で入社してました。
F に関して言うとね、スクエアニクスといいますか、スクエアが初めて、オンラインのあれだけの規模 の、MMORPG 日本でやるっていうのは、もう本当初めてだったんで、いや、もう正直、いろんなことがありましたね、当時ね。こんなん言っちゃっていいのかな、言っちゃっていいの?OK なの？あ、いいんだ。まずね、どういうことがあったかというと、あの時はMMO とかね、海外で例えばウルティマとか、そういった先行事例があるんだけど、基本的に PC ですよね。ところが、だから今週までやるなんてもう無謀の極みだとかってね、もうたくさんそういうふうに言われました。ソニーさんがPS2 のハードディスク BB キットなんかもですね、もう何台出すんだとか、アンドガツそういうのすったもんだして、いろんなことがありましたんで、ほとんど不可能だとかでよく言われてましたよ、実際には。成功なんて
11 was my first MMO. I hadn't played one before. I remember purchasing the PlayStation 2 broadband unit because they were all sold out. I ended up paying double on like some Yahoo auction or something like that. Ridiculous, but I had to play it. We got a new internet connection. We were on a regular modem at that time, but because, you know, we needed a new modem, we had to upgrade to ISDN 128, you know. But yeah, it was definitely worth it. It was something that was completely new to me, but, you know, fascinating. And ever since then, I've, you know, been into MMOs. That was the gateway drug for me, you know, going in from FF11 and then trying, you know, some of the Western MMOs as well, getting into World of Warcraft, seeing the differences between the two.
Personally, I think it's very different, I mean, here in Japan from the Western market because, yeah, it is for everyone in the globe. I mean, it's very first MMORPG on the console, PlayStation 2. And also, I mean, it was the first ever cross-platform MMO between PlayStation 2 and Xbox 360. The obvious one is the most Japanese people don't really like to speak, I mean, chat in public.
Right.
So, I mean, in the world, there's a lot of characters, but it's very quiet because people are using a tell instead of the say or shout. And then, but if you go to the Western world, game world, I mean, everyone is shouting around. So yeah, that's a huge difference.
You know, while in the West, you know, you have your EverQuests and you have your Ultima Onlines. In Japan, there was none of that. And then, so Final Fantasy XI was really one of the first MMOs in Japan. And so getting to work with basically the pioneers of the Japanese MMO was really exciting. On the other hand, I mean, you could also say that it was possibly kind of a curse in the sense that they were all, you know, doing their own thing. They had their vision of what an MMO should be and what a Japanese MMO should be. And then me, again, not having played an MMO before, getting on this team and thinking, okay, this is an MMO and translating away and working in that project, I kind of, you know, started thinking, okay, this is what an MMO is, this is what an MMO is. And then that one day I start playing WoW and it's like, oh. Seeing the differences between the two and saying like, okay, what I thought was the norm in Final Fantasy XI, you know, the grinding for 20 hours to go up one level and then only to have your level drop when you, you know, pull too many crabs and it kills you and you've lost 5 hours work. Like, I thought that was normal. And then you're like, well, that's not normal, is it? The Japanese base game, Final Fantasy XI, had already released, and they were working on the first expansion pack, Rise of the Zalart. I was part of the team that was working to get the base game and Rise of Zalart all translated before the Japanese Rise of Zalart was finished, so we could all release at the same time.
Right. Did you get it on time?
I got it on time. I haven't missed a deadline yet. That's one thing I'm proud of.
Final Fantasy XI was a huge success for Square Enix. It established a concurrent user base of around 250,000 players for years. It was the most profitable Final Fantasy game ever, and at one stage was the sixth most popular game on all of Xbox Live. More than that, it established the Japanese style of MMO. And when the decision was made in 2005 to start work on a sequel, the new MMO was built around things that made 11 successful, focusing, like most Final Fantasy games do, on beautiful graphics and an interesting battle system. This new game was to be directed and produced by the same duo that shipped 11, series veteran Hiromichi Tanaka and Nobuaki Komodo. Final Fantasy XIV was announced for Windows and PlayStation 3 in 2009, but behind the scenes, the development team was struggling to put the pieces of its new world together.
Final Fantasy XIV の最初のバージョンの自分が見た時の一番大きな問題点、最終的にそれが問題だったと考えているものっていうのは、その最初のコンセプトとして、そのプランナーがスクリプトを書くことによってとゲームを作っていこう。で、利点としては、プランナーが考えて自分たちで実装するんで、高速な開発ができる。要はそうじゃないと基本的にはプランナーさんはものを考えて開発者にエンジニアに相談してどう実装するかを決めて、で、ゲームデザインをする人はそのどういうパラメータをいじりたいかとかを相談しながらエンジニアと話をしてものを作っていかなきゃいけないんですけれども、そこの部分に関してスクリプトを導入すると自分で考えて自分で実現することができるようになるっていう発想で、ゲーム実装の大半がスクリプトで組まれてたんですね。 でそのスクリプト UI の問題もそうなんですけれども、ゲームも UI も基本的にはスクリプトで書かれていて、でスクリプトを動かすエンジン側がかなりと負荷が高いというか CPU をたくさん使わないと動かない状態になっているので、まあ、ちょっとした何かをするだけでも、ゲーム内で少し何かをするだけでもと非常に CPU リソースを使うことになっていて、まあ、すぐにこうサーバーが回るサイクルが遅くなっていくということが問題として発生していました。で結果としてそのサーバーでできることは少ない、あとゲームとしてサーバーで実現できるところは少ないですし、と何かしようとすると負荷が上がっちゃうんで、じゃあそれを回避するためにどうしようとかっていうことで、結果的にそのゲーム内容としてリッチなものが実現できなくなっているってことが起きてましたね。で UI もスクリプトで組まれていたので、まあ、なんかちょっと処理するだけでもすごい時間がかかるっていうような問題が発生していました。
Like I mentioned before, again, localization being in a position where we get to see all the parts come together first, we were some of the first to realize that, you know, Houston, we have a problem, that type of situation. I mean, you know, you had the battle team, they're like, yes, we have this great battle system, you know, with stamina and these things that you could do. And then you had the story team, like, yes, we have this story. Oh, hey, we have these guild leaves and all of these parts. And everyone was really, really proud of their parts. You know, look at this grass, it's so beautiful. Look at this barrel, it's the...you know, the most beautiful barrel ever to be, you know, represented in graphical form.
It's got as many polygons as the character.
Yes. And all of those parts, you know, all of these teams, again, very, very proud of their work. I mean, you have, the team was, you know, put together with some of the best minds in Square Enix. You had people that were, you know, leads that could probably even, you know, create, lead their own projects were all come together. AndIt became a lot of just tiny little groups making something that was really great. But once you put it together, it was kind of a mess. And no one really knew that, except for localization and probably QA as well. And we were like, okay, we need to do something. But by then it was one of those, it's kind of too late to do anything. But for us, we would be looking at the text and some of it, you know, it wouldn't make sense or it would just be very bland.And thinking, if there's any way to make this game better, what can we do? It's like, well, I can take this text and maybe add some more stuff into it, add some more flavor to it, and you know, maybe that will distract people from the fact that the battle is not that fun.
At a fundamental level, the piecemeal design of the game was causing problems. Graphics were inconsistent. While many elements of the world were copy and pasted ad nauseum, some environmental objects had as many polygons and shaders as a character model. The battle system was just confusing. The game didn't have elements fundamental to most modern MMOs, things like jumping, auto attack, and the ability to interact with the map using a mouse. It had a system that nerfed hardcore players to make sure they didn't level up too fast. The UI was confusing, crafting was incredibly complex and took forever, and simply there just wasn't enough content. The closed beta wasn't going well. They needed more time to fix these problems, so the open beta was pushed back to within a month before launch. The team knew there were problems, and they were getting frustrated.
で、まあ、今まで話していた仕事っていうのは大体その2010年の1月からまあ、実際にリリースされる 8月ぐらいまでの間にやっていたことで、で、まあ、ゲームが本当に良くないっていうのがこう、まあ、みんなに認識されて自覚されていくっていうのは結局ベータが始まって製品版が始まってっていう、まあ、8月9月10月ぐらいまでの期間に起きたことなんですね。でと実際にはこうチーム内の意識としてもとリリース前そのベータが始まる前からと本当にこれをリリースしていいものかどうかっていう議論はある程度そのチーム全体でオフィシャルであったわけではないですけれども、まあ、開発者の中ではやはりその世に出していいクオリティかどうかっていうところはと議論がありました。
When 1.0 was getting made, was the mentality that, oh, we're not like, that's like their thing, and we have our very own successful thing over here, we're going to just make another one of those.
Right.And that's really what it felt like, is that we're going to continue doing what we did because it succeeded before. Why wouldn't it succeed again? And seeing that direction, you know, them taking that direction and knowing that, you know, having worked on 11, that yes, they were very successful, seeing the success that they had with Final Fantasy 11, seeing these great creators, you know, creating something that was, I mean, revolutionary. But then on the other hand, knowing that what they were doing was, yeah, but maybe that might not, that worked 6 or 7 years ago, but a lot of things have changed since then. And I mean, I think there was even one guy on the localization team that got to that point where he just got so frustrated that he just wrote this scathing mail and sent it out to the whole team before telling anyone else on localization he was going to write it. And then we all get it at the same time, the devs team, we're reading, it's like, wow, this is really terrible. I hope he doesn't, oh, he sent it to the whole team. Because he just got really frustrated, right? Because he could, to him, I mean, they were being very stubborn. They weren't, you know, they hadn't moved on. Whereas the rest of the world had moved on and adapted, you know, with the release of WoW and what they had done. Whereas, you know, the team here was like, no, we're going to stick with what we know, and that's good enough.
Then start feeling more about, more concerning the situation. I mean, this is not fixed, not fixed, not fixed. Oh, then, oh, you announced the launch date, but it's not fixed. So, yeah, but still, the some major portion people are still thinking, still believing, oh, no, no, it's better, still better. Better phase, last phase, but still better. So it could be, I mean, fixed or the change at the launch timing. So.
Kind of went from thinking, okay, this project's going to be great, to, uh-oh, there might be some problems. Can we fix them? Can we fix them? Okay, we can't fix them. Is there anything we can do? I don't know. It was a very taxing experience.
The team crossed their fingers and hoped that the game's beta problems were simply that, the same issues that most MMOs have, ones that could be fixed with patches once the game entered live operations. And so Final Fantasy XIV Online launched on September 30th, 2010. It sold well its first week, and after a month had over 600,000 players swarming into its world. But it didn't take long for the cracks to appear. The problems in the beta were echoed by new players. The game was sluggish, the servers crashed, and Eorzeans quickly ran out of things to do. Quests were limited, and the fatigue system even made grinding for XP next to impossible. Critics ate it alive too.
Let's get right down to it. Unless you've got the patience of Job or some kind of masochist, you shouldn't play Final Fantasy XIV. Its problems are so vast that I could spend hours talking about them. The awful interface, the recycled content, the stringent limits on questing, the useless maps, the stupid market ward, these issues and dozens more constantly have you asking that age-old question, what were they thinking?
So, what was it like seeing public reaction?
Yeah, it was very, I mean, very disheartening. Because, you know, you'd wanna look at those and you'd wanna say, no, they don't understand, they don't know, you know, what's going on here, or you know, but deep down, you'd know they were right. And that was what kind of, you know, that dagger in your heart and it's twisting, because, you know, you wanna defend what you worked on. I mean, the people that I worked with are the greatest people. I mean, I still, you know, work with a lot of them. I had worked with them before in FF11. I consider them not only coworkers but friends. But, you know, and then you see people online, you know, bashing the work they did, and I know how hard they worked. I know how many hours they put in. I know that, like, in the last 3 or 4 months, people were basically living at work, all putting their 100% into this game that was, you know, destined to kind of crash and burn. But, and then to have people online just say, oh, that sucks, this person is a piece of shit, and their work is terrible, it hurts. But it hurts more because if I was not here and was a user and had played that game, I probably would have said the same thing.
そうですね、まあ、当時もね、私はCFをやってたんで、なんですけれども、ローンチのタイミングやっぱり一番大きく違ったのは、11の時のいろいろごたごたねと、9の14の時のごたごた一番違うっていうのは、11の時はいろいろごたごたあったけど、ゲームに関して言うとさすがに相当やっぱり、その程度やっぱり受け入れ、ファン相当のやっぱり評価されたんですよね。で、まあ、オペレーション上の、ね、トラブルとかっていろいろ多分あるっていう、まあ、これはある程度つきもので、まあ、大変だったんですけれども、まあ、それはあったんですけど、ゲーム内容に関して言うと非常にまあ評価されたというふうに理解してますけれども、前作の場合の一番やっぱ私はちょっと まずいなこれって思ったのは、やっぱりゲーム自体の評価が非常に厳しいものだったということですね。これはちょっとやっぱり相当大丈夫かなというのを、まあ、ローンチした後ね、やっぱりそこはね、非常にリアルに感じましたね。 それはそうですね、まあ、ローンチして、まあ、しばらく経って、まあ、そんなに長い期間じゃなかったですね。そういうしばらくなんで、やっぱり相当な、このままで大丈夫なのかという、社内でも相当やっぱり議論ありましたね。
I mean, the first few months was just an endless stream of translating apology mails from, you know, producers and directors and you know, finding out, trying to figure out different ways of saying we're sorry, because the more you say it, the less weight it has. But Japan being a country where, you know, people apologize a lot, that's part of the culture. But then trying to translate that, it's like, okay, this is the 10th time I've said sorry in this one post. And then from, you know, the American myself, it's like, yeah, people are going to look at that as insincere. You know, the more you apologize, the more insincere. And then trying to explain that to the team, it's like, no, we have to apologize. It's like, yes, you have to apologize. But, and it just became, we weren't talking about the game anymore. We were talking about how to translate apologies. And it seemed like that lasted for, you know, a couple months.
Actually, we see a huge drop. I mean, right after the launching. Launch timing, we got good number of the subscribers. Then that fall, I mean, as you can imagine. So, I mean, it was failure, and we announced failure. So we see lots of decline.
さっきも話した通り、実際にはその開発内でも、その今リリースすべきかっていうか、リリースできるクオリティにあるかっていうのは、と、まあ、ベータ直前とかベータが始まってもそうなんですけど、常に疑問はあったので、と、まあ、リリースして実際にそのただまあ、それまでにチーム内にやった空気はそのやはり出したら意外と受け入れられる可能性があるんじゃないかっていうその漠然としたその出せばどうにかなるのかもその自分たちが持っているほど悪くないのかもっていうその何の根拠もないと希望的なものがあったんですよ。で出た結果結局そんな魔法は起きなくてやはりその自分たちが感じている通りにとまあ、まだ世に出すには早いというか世に出せるクオリティに到達していない商品を出してしまったっていう気持ちはみんなにあったんで実際にその改善しなきゃっていうか根本的に対応しなきゃいけないっていうところはとチーム内に割とすぐ広がったと思ってます。なので特にすごいそんなことはないっていう意見がすごく強くあって誰かを説得しなきゃいけないみたいなことは特になかったですね。
Today, Square Enix is based across multiple floors in a modern office complex in Shinjuku, Tokyo. It's a company that is often designing multiple projects at once. And while Final Fantasy XIV was being developed, in another part of the building a different game was being made. Produced by a Final Fantasy fan, his name? Naoki Yoshida.
The first time I was a family computer, in the US, the entertainment system.のマリオブラザーズが一番最初にプレイしたゲームです。とにかくそのテレビの中、テレビっていうのはその見るものだと思っていた子供の時に。ところがそのマリオブラザーズで初めてそのコントローラーを握ってゲームをプレイした時に、まずそもそもテレビのものを自分が自由に動かせるっていうことがものすごいショックで、友達の家でプレイさせてもらったんだけど、ものすごい興奮したのを覚えてます。ドラゴンクエストっていう日本で RPG を、まあ、大きく広めたタイトルを初めて触った時にアクションではないゲーム数字のやり取りでこんなにまたさらにゲームは面白くなるんだっていうのを特にストーリーラインがあってっていうまた次のカルチャーショックを受けて RPG っていうジャンルにものすごくなんだろうフォーカスしていくことになったかなとは思います。当然その翌年に出たファイナルファンタジーにもその映画的なその演出ファンタジーをより強く打ち出したっていうところにもすごい衝撃を受けてたのでやっぱり僕の中でドラゴンクエストとファイナルファンタジーっていうのはすごい大きかったですね当時。
Like most Japanese players at the time, Yoshida-san played all the early Final Fantasy games. He holds them in high regard, though he still holds the bitter memory of not being able to save before the last dungeon in Final Fantasy III. But when he was 11 years old, a brand new type of gaming experience arrived at home.His uncle gave him a PC. On this PC, the young gamer learned how to program BASIC. His first video game centered around trying to break into a bank vault. But this PC also exposed him to a spectrum of gaming that eluded most Japanese players, Western role-playing games. He fell in love with games like Diablo and was stunned when he first went online and played with other players.
で、その翌年にウルティマオンラインをベータから プレイし、先輩にとにかくすげえゲームあるって言われて、ウルティマオンラインをベータから始めたのが初めて MMO をプレイした作品で、やっぱり同じようなその3回目の衝撃、3000人が同時に一つの世界で遊ぶっていうのがもうとてつもないまた衝撃でしたね。まあウルティマは本当に自由度の、ウルティマオンラインは特にとにかく初期は自由度がめちゃくちゃ高いゲームだったので、そのいわゆるロードの称号をつけた、そのなんて言ったらいいんだろうな、すごく紳士的なというかコミュニティリーダー的プレイをするキャラクターと、完全に悪のプレイヤーキラーをやるキャラクターを2つ作って、どっちもものすごい遊んでたし、やっぱりその MMORPG っていうゲームがどう作られてるのか、どういったエンジニアリングが必要なのかっていうのもものすごいそこで勉強させてもらったと思います。もうその頃からはコンソールと同じぐらいの比重で PC でゲームをかなり遊ぶようになってたので、自分で PC パーツ買ってきて組み立てたりしてたし、でやっぱりそのあたりで FPS もかなりプレイし始めてたし、特に 3DMMO のスタートであるエヴァクエスト、その後プレイをし始めて、当時エヴァクエストのパッケージを日本で手に入れるのが本当に大変で、出張で東京に来た時に秋葉原をね、時間を作ってゾンビのように店をこううろうろして、エヴァクエストってゲームないですか、エヴァクエストってないですかって。
Yoshida-san would embark on a career in games that would eventually see him joining Square Enix to work on the Dragon Quest series. Though he wasn't working on the Final Fantasy team, he was part of the umbrella group that was allocating programmers to various projects. He didn't have granular visibility on FF14, but he knew the team was struggling. I asked from his perspective as a producer where he thought the game's problems were coming from.
まあ、わかんない。これ広報にカットされるのかもしれないけど、クリスタルツールズって呼ばれるミドルウェアを全社でその作ろうとしていたので、腕のいいプログラマーが全部そのチームに、あの各なんだろう、ゲームラインから招集されて、そのメインプログラマーがみんないないっていう状態になってしまったので、どのプロジェクトもものすごい大変な時期だった。まあオリジナルの14がああなったってしまった理由の一つでもあるかなとは思いますね。さらに2つ大きな問題がそこに絡まっていて、スクエアエニックスその全体にプレイステーション2のジェネレーションで本当に世界一クオリティ、グラフィックスのクオリティが高い、そしてゲームエクスペリエンスがものすごく詰まったゲームっていうのをたくさんリリースしたので、本当にこうなんて言うんだろう、ある意味自信過剰にもうなっていた時期で、自分たちが世界一だし、自分たちのグラフィックスこそが世界一だし、その作り方はその自分たちにしかできない、だからなんだろう、でも超巨大な成功体験ってやっぱり足かせというかにもなる例だと思うんですけど、ものすごくおごってた、まあ悪い言い方をすればおごってた時期だったと思うんですね。まず例えると、その刀を作る刀匠のような職人たちが本当にたくさんいて、彼らが一つずつを手作りで作って、あの世界一のクオリティを作り上げていたんだけど、実は世界は、まあ、特にその北米を中心にテクノロジーでそれをカバーするっていうところをずっと追求してきた時期で、プレイステーション3の世代になった瞬間にテクノロジーの方がそれを上回るっていう時期が来たせいで、作り方を変えようとはしないし、だけどテクノロジーも追いつけないっていうことから、さらにそれを知ってるはずのプログラマーたちはミドルウェアの制作に行ってるっていう状態で、でもグラフィックス作ってるそのアーティストたちは自分たちの作り方こそが世界一だと思ってるので、古い作り方で引き続きものすごく負荷のかかるやり方でアセットを作ってたので、もうそれらが絡まってっていうのが、まあもう一つの大きな さっき2つあるって言った問題の1つ目がそれですね。もう1つはプライドはいついかなる時でもとても大切なものだとは思うんですけど、そこにやっぱり超巨大な成功体験をしたっていうこと自体が乗っかってきちゃうと、その自分たちの作るゲームこそがベストであって他をあんまり見る必要がないっていう時期でもあったんじゃないかなと思っていて、例えば当時世界多分 MMORPG を知ってる人に世界最大の MMORPG は何ですかって言ったら100人に聞いたら100人がワールドオブクラフトって言ったはずなのに誰もプレイしてない、開発チームが。これはワールドオブウォークラフトを知ってるか知ってないかっていう話だけの話をしてるんじゃなくて、その自分たちが世の中に対して新しいそのビデオゲームをリリースしようとするときにライバルになるタイトルは何だろうとか、ユーザーは今プレイヤーはどこにそのゲームエクスペリエンスの最新の状態をプレイしてるんだろうっていうのを知らないっていうのが、その感覚として僕には結構信じられない。なんでもっとみんなゲームプレイしないの、だって自分たちが今 どのあたりにいるか分かんなくなっちゃうよっていうのがまあ言いたいで、特に14の場合に関してはもちろんファイナルファンタジー11の超巨大な成功体験っていうのが邪魔をしたっていうのもあるとは思うんだけど、あの当時はエバークエストを徹底的にプレイをしてだからこそ11を作ったはずなのに、新しいレストランをオープンするときに隣にあるレストランがどんなメニューを出していてどんなサービスをしているかを知らずにレストランを作る回転させる人はいないんじゃないって。
So, just at the launch stage then of 1.0, what was the feeling within Square Enix? The beta was quite close to launch. Were people anticipating that there would be negative feedback, or were they less aware that that was going to happen, I guess?
僕は他のチームにいて、すごくベータの評判が悪いっていうのはネットでニュースは見てましたね。ただ多かれ少なかれ MMORPG のローンチは絶対に、まあ、荒れやすい、そのサーバーがすぐ落ちるとか、まあ、テストストレステストをやってるけどプレイヤーの方は遊びたいからやっぱりサーバーが落ちるとやっぱりすごく文句を言って当然だと思いますし、ね、だから僕もやっぱり11を作ったチームだから、まあそうは言っても11のやっぱり完成度が高いのでそこと比較をしてあの機能がないこの機能がないっていう話をしてるのかなっていうふうに思ってた。僕は僕自身の開発が忙しかったのもあって、ただそれも少しずつ収まっていくんだろうなっていうふうに僕は当時は見てた。ただ別の角度、今度はそのオリジナルの14チームの中のその視点としてはこのままだと本当にまずいもっと時間をかけて品質を上げないとっていう、もちろん声を上げる人たちもいたけれど、会社って、まあ、全体の判断としてはファイナルファンタジー11のスタートもそうだったと、機能たくさんなかったしものすごくネガティブなフィードバックもたくさん来たけどパッチでどんどん直していって11は完成したんだから14も大丈夫だと、最初は絶対こうなんだっていうふうに判断したのでベータを終わらせてリリース F 見切ったっていうのが当時のジャッジだったって、僕はチームに入ってからインタビューをしてそれを確認したので、チームの中ではやっぱり議論はあったそうです、あのままじゃダメまずいっていう話は。ただ最終的なジャッジは今お話しした通り11の時もそうだった、でも11だってずっとパッチを続けてああなったじゃないかと。
Eventually, corporate realized that this wasn't usual launch problems, so they called on a few select members of the team to create a task force. This task force would research what changes the game needed and the resources the development environment would require to do the work. Members of that team would talk to Yoshida-san about their worries after hours. His thoughts were that the current organizational structure would need to be modified if the team was going to make the changes required. In October of 2010, Yoshida-san talked to the then Square Enix president Yoichi Wada and suggested they initiate a company-wide emergency to get the team the resources they needed. Wada-san spent a few days talking to the 14 development team about their concerns, and while a lot of the team had suggested that the current task force was in fact up to the task, Some members of the 14 team had pleaded to have Yoshida-san join the project to help. And so it transpired that in late November, corporate took the decision to remove Hiromichi Tanaka from the team and move Nobuaki Komoto from director to lead designer. Both of their vacant positions would be filled by Yoshida-san. At that time, he was leading a team that was working on an original IP for Square Enix. He was disappointed to leave that team, but excited for the opportunity to work on one of the company's crown jewels, a numbered Final Fantasy game. So, he got right to work.
やらなきゃいけないことは当時3つあると思ってて、まあ順番にやってたんですけど、まずそのチームに、まあオリジナルのチームにトップが変わります。で、あとそのタスクフォースメンバーもそのまま開発コアとしてリードに入りますっていう当然話をしなきゃいけない全チームに。ただ僕はドラゴンクエスト側のゲームを開発することが多かったので、そのほとんどのスタッフを知らないというか、まあ顔と名前ぐらいは知ってるスタッフはいたけど、その一緒に仕事したことがある人がほとんどいなかったので、まず Say Hello っていうところからで、一度もはみんな仕事したことがないから、どんな仕事をする人間なのかを見てくれればいいよって、まずで、あ、こいつダメだと思ったら、あのチーム抜けて構わないからっていう話を最初にして、一緒に仕事してみよう、でも1回はいいよねって、でそれでダメだと思ったら本当すぐ抜けて構わないから3ヶ月ぐらいまず一緒にやろうよっていう話を僕スピーチでした記憶があります。で、まあもう1回チャレンジするよ、まあ、当然その時その申請するなんて話はまだ計画がなかったので、とにかく立て直しをやるよと、ギブアップはしないよっていう話をした時に、僕を知ってる何人かはよしやるぞっていう人たちと、もう無理だよっていう人たちと、なんだよこの急な体制変更って言って、まあ怒ってる雰囲気の人たちとっていうのが大体のその時の雰囲気でしたね。まあそんな中で今もあの14のサウンドディレクターやってる祖健が、まあその話をしてた時と大きなホールだったんですけど、2階のサウンドブースで僕のマイクの調整とかやってくれてて、その祖健があいつだけですよやり直すぞっていうか、そのリベンジするぞって言ったらガッツポーズしてたのはあいつだけです。今でも覚えてますよ、2階席でおっしゃーってやってたんで、あいつ。
I saw both reactions. I saw the, oh my God, we just went through a year of hell and now he's asking us to go through a year and a half of hell to this point that might, you know, be another failure because, you know, no one had taken a game and rebuilt it in this manner before. So basically saying like, yeah, you just have to trust me and yeah, you could, you know, waste another year and a half of your life and it could be a failure and, you know,but you're going to have to believe me on this one. And so, yeah, a lot of people are like, I can't do this anymore, I don't know. And I can understand that because again, it was a gamble. But then on the other hand, there were, I mean, a lot of us, you know, myself included, but I mean, a lot of people on the team that were like, no, I mean, we worked so hard on this and we did our jobs the best that we could, but for a lot of, you know, reasons, some circumstances that were out of our control,you know, decisions made by higher ups, decisions made by other teams that, you know, affected our work and nothing that we could do about it. But we had put our all into it and we were invested in the project. And we still believed in the project. To have someone from the outside come in and not just come in to say, okay, you know, forget it, we're just going to do it my way or the highway. He's like, he asked our opinions. He laid out a roadmap. He gave us a vision and a hope. And even though it seemed like it would be difficult to achieve, it didn't seem inconceivable.
Yoshi-P knew there was no time to wait. He worked with corporate to make sure the team had time off, both for them to relax, but also to give him time to build his new vision, to do research playing other MMOs, and to help draft his plan, to deliver the vision and how the team was going to do it. They had very little time to fix this game, so once they started, the specifications document would have to be watertight. And as captain of the ship, he needed to be able to answer every question the team may have. Quickly. Yoshida-san was now at the helm of his first Final Fantasy, and as an avid MMO fan, he was looking forward to getting in there and fixing it. What he couldn't have known at this stage was the scale of the job ahead of him, that no matter how much they patched Final Fantasy XIV online, they couldn't ever fix it. What they'd have to do was something that no developer had ever done, to rebuild an entire MMO
while the original version was still running.
I don't think that they realized immediately that it was something that couldn't be solved via patches. I think they still believe that, you know, if we patch it, it'll be fine. And it wasn't until they reevaluated and then brought in, you know, the new blood. Yoshida-san came in and told them, okay, yeah, this is not something that can be patched. If we want to fix this, we're going to have to take a drastic step.
Yoshida spent 7 weeks researching and returned with two options for corporate. It was then he realized that it would be impossible to convert the current game into an MMO that could last the test of time. Ultimately, though, this was a decision that corporate had to make. So he returned with not one, but two plans, Plan A and Plan B. During this meeting, he explained that Plan A would be to patch the game and make it more playable, but that ultimately the game would never really satisfy players, and though Square Enix may make their money back, the damage to the online brand would be catastrophic. And then there was Plan B.
今のファイナルファンタジー14を、パッチを当てて、その、できる限り、ポジティブに遊べるものに、しながら、裏で、全く新しいそのファイナルファンタジー14を、もう一度作り直すっていうのが、プラン B。で、まあ、その話では結構聞くと、まあ、そんなバカなってなるので、当然。どうやってそれを達成するか、チームを、二つに分けて。で、どういった、そのマネジメントスタイルでそれをやるのか。で、大体、発売時期はプレイステーション3版をリリースするっていうのが、 プレイヤーとの約束だったので、プレイステーション3の寿命が来る前にリリースしなきゃいけないので、2012年年末から2013年中には絶対リリースできるこの計画であればっていうプレゼンテーションをして、リスクは高い。ただ、当然そんなことをしたことはないし、ゲーム業界で。しかも同じタイトルで作り直してるから、成功、うまくいったとしても成功するかどうかわからない。ただ少なくとも、 やっぱりファイナルファンタジーってクレイジーだねとか、すごいことするねとか、少なくとも自分たちがミスしたことを認めて、信頼を取り戻そうとしたっていう努力は、見てくれてる人は多分見てくれるだろう。だから、どっちをチョイスするかは、会社に任せる。ただ、どっちであっても全力でやるよっていう話をプレゼンテーションして、まあ、結果的にはね、プラン B でって言ってくれたんで、
Final Fantasy XIV 1.0 was in a state of disarray. Square Enix had decided to suspend subscriptions to help ease the negativity around the game, while the PS3 version was indefinitely postponed. For the next 2 years, Yoshida-san and his team would work tirelessly on not one, but two MMOs, patching the original 1.0 to fans' expectations while secretly working on a brand new version of Final Fantasy XIV. In our next episode, we focus on that 2 year period and tell the incredible story of the falling moon of Dalamud, the death of 1.0, and the birth of a new Eorzea.